The whole purpose of this one is to understand what's the right consultation process, what's the right consenting process that will help us safeguard our practice. The bottom line is, it is better patient education, better communication, and preventing medical legal problems. There's always a first consultation, and the consultation needs to have a structure of consultation. It's usually, you will see, it's the same pattern. There's nothing needs to be varied. The way you ask the patient their concerns, you break the ice, you ask the patient's concern, you listen to the patient's concern, simultaneously you write it down and make a note of that, you ask further questions, you ask medical history, you ask all of those relevant questions, okay? And then you do a quick analysis. Obviously, there is a limited time during the first consultation. You will not be able to cover everything. And it's also fair not to give an assessment plan at the same time. You can always tell the patient that, look, I know all the details. I don't have a plan in mind for you now. Please go back. We'll call you back again. And then we will further discuss, and then I'll give you my plan. Now, these are more in reconstructive cases. These are more in multiple complex cases. So it's okay not to give your decision right away, okay? Except for straightforward cases. Now, once you have done the consultation, obviously you would cover the essential parts of the medical history. You would cover the plan, alternative plan. You will give them options, okay? You will cover a brief about what will happen during the surgery, after the surgery, recovery, and a very brief about risks. But you will tell them there are a lot to discuss, but it's best that you take the booklet, whether it's a printed booklet or e-booklet, to go through it, which will have a lot more information which we could not discuss in this time. Now, these information will help you get more questions. So when you come next time, I'll be happy to answer those questions. So it's mandatory that you give out this booklet. And now, for, of course, cost reason, we have e-booklet. So don't expect printed booklet, e-booklet. Just make sure you know where, who has it, when the patient gets it. Now, when the patient gets the booklet, there is an acknowledgement form that you have to tell the patient that please sign this form once you have taken the booklet and give it back to the nurse. It should happen during the first consultation. So that's an evidence that you have done all of those things and given. That's your responsibility is partially over. Okay?
So for the e-booklet, we need to acknowledge...
We'll do the discussion later on. Just make a note of that because it's recording. Okay. Those are the e-booklet. So once you have given the e-booklet, now it is patient's responsibility to go and do further research and reading. Alright. So once that happens, then the role comes to patient coordination. The patient coordinator's job is financial arrangements. Okay. The logistics, when, how to have the second appointment, pre-operative and surgery, and steps until the surgery and after the surgery to explain to the patient what will happen after the surgery. Alright, so that's patient coordination's role. Now, nurses' coordination is, they will do preoperatively, but what they are responsible to do preoperatively are the things like parameters, like measurements for the garment. But other assessment needs to be done by doctors. Alright. Nurses' coordination also involves post-operative. But again, you need to liaise with the nurse to make sure that the patient, nurses have called the patient if you have forgotten to call the patient. I don't call the patient now anymore. I used to do that in the past. But then you can quickly tell the nurses, did you call up? And most of the time they would have. But if not, just ask them to call the patient to find out how they are and to ensure that they have their next follow-up booked. It is our responsibility if the follow-up is not booked, patient does not come up, and if the patient has complication. According to medical legal laws, it is our responsibility. So make sure that it is recorded that you have called the patient, you have in the discharge card, you have to mention that the patient is called on this day, this number, or call emergency call to this doctor. Once you have done that, that's, you're safe. Okay?
We write on this
questions
number.
Afterwards. So yes, we write the numbers and then make sure that the nurses have called the patient to arrange the post-operative booking. Now, we are fortunate we have automatic system, but don't assume. Okay. Now, once that has happened, often the patient will either come for a second consultation, and the second consultation should always be for multiple procedures. should be for rhinoplasty. Do not book procedure after one consultation. Should be for augmentation mastopexy, because these are the most litigational procedures, and it's worldwide. Or the second consultation is also during the preoperative workup. Okay, so that's also officially considered a second consultation. According to DHA, all the surgeries that you do must have these two consultations, which is signed and recorded by doctors. Now, second consultation is basically, either when you are doing pre-op or you are doing second consultation, the patient will ask questions. Do encourage them to ask questions. If the second consultation is after a long duration of the first consultation, quickly again go through assessment, assess, and then go through the steps. Take them through the steps of the surgery. Tell them on the day of the surgery, you will come to the patient, you will do the marking and drawing. If you have any more final questions, you can ask at that time, but that's the final decision there. We will not be able to change any plans then. Okay. Often patient will say that on the day of the surgery, I want this, this, this. You clear it in the second consultation? No. You want whatever? You tell us now, because then it needs to be accounted as well, or documented at the same time. So this, you have to explain to the patient that the surgery will be here. It will be this anesthesia, it may take this much time, you will be post-operatively in the ward or hospital for this much time, you will follow up, there is a possibility you might stay back another, do check with the coordinators what your package covers. Anything that does not covers, it's your responsibility, and that's okay to stay, and we can help you with getting a better price. Spell it out, it makes a big difference. So once you have discussed that, then you do the preoperative assessment. I have really spent a lot of time in gathering all of the papers. You have got it automatically in your hand. Don't disregard it. Okay? There's a lot of effort that I have done, a lot of hours that I have spent preparing those. Go through that, and it's okay to improve it. If you want any suggestion or you feel that it's unnecessary, cut it down. That's okay. But the essential thing needs to be recorded. Okay? Because these recordings will prove what it was before. Now, when the patient gets the booklet, there is an acknowledgement form that you have to tell the patient that please sign this form once you have taken the booklet and give it back to the nurse. It should happen during the first consultation. So that's an evidence that you have done all of those things and given. That's your response. So once you have given the e-booklet, now it is patient's responsibility to go and do further research and reading. So once that happens, then the role comes to patient coordination. The patient coordinator's job is financial arrangement, okay? The logistics, when, how to have the second appointment, pre-operative and surgery, steps until the surgery and after the surgery, to explain to the patient what will happen after the surgery. Now, nurses' coordination is they will do pre-operatively, but what they are responsible to do pre-operatively are the things like parameters, measurements for the garment. But other assessment needs to be done by doctors. Nurses' coordination also involves post-operative. But again, you need to liaise with the nurse to make sure that the patient, nurses have called the patient if you have forgotten to call the patient. But then you can quickly tell the nurses, did you call up? And most of the time they would have. But if not, just ask them to call the patient to find out how they are and to ensure that they have their next follow-up booked. It is our responsibility if the follow-up is not booked, patient does not come up, and if the patient has complication. So make sure that it is recorded that you have called the patient, you have in the discharge card, you have to mention that the patient is called on this day, this number, or call emergency call to this doctor. Once that has happened, often the patient will either come for a second consultation, and the second consultation should always be for multiple procedures, should be for rhinoplasty, do not book procedure after one consultation, should be for augmentation mastopexy. Because these are the most, or the second consultation is also during the preoperative workup. Okay, so that's also officially considered a second consultation. All the surgeries that you do must have these two consultations, which is signed and recorded by doctors. Now, second consultation is basically, either when you are doing pre-op or you are doing second consultation, the patient will ask questions. Do encourage them to ask questions. If the second consultation is after a long duration of the first consultation, quickly again go through assessment, assess, and then go through the steps. Take them through the steps of the surgery. tell them on the day of the surgery you will come to the patient, you will do the marking and drawing. If you have any more final questions, you can ask at that time, but that's the final decision there. We will not be able to change any plans then. Okay, often patient will say that on the day of the surgery, I want this, this, this. You clear it in the second consultation? No. You want whatever? You tell us now. Because then it needs to be accounted as well or documented at the same time. So this, you have to explain to the patient that you will, the surgery will be here. It will be this anesthesia. It may take this much time. You will be post-operatively in the ward or hospital for this much time. You will follow up. There is a possibility you might stay back another. Do check with the coordinators what your package covers. Anything that does not covers, it's your responsibility and that's okay to stay, and we can help you with getting a better price. Spell it out. It makes a big difference. So once you have discussed that, then you do the preoperative assessment. So make sure that you do a preoperative assessment and sign your name. So once you have done the recording data, then you sit down with the informed consent book. And this is what is very important that I want to go through with you. Breast lift and implant. Okay. So you sit down with the patient and say, let's discuss a few important things with you. Now, what does the breast lift and implant say? So there is a general information. I assume that you have gone through. You're asking the patient. If you have any question, you can ask me, but let's discuss some of the risk factors that we want to avoid. So you tell them that there are risks with the surgeries, but this is what we have done in the past to avoid these complications, or this is what I would do to prevent these complications. So what it says is inherent risk of breast implants. So you're going to talk about what kind of implant you use, how it is better than the previous implants. These are cohesive implants. They do not leak. They can break. Even if they break, you can demonstrate it with one of the implant that we have, that it does not spread. It remains within the capsule, because the body forms capsule around the implant within 3 months. And it's unlikely that the implant will leak before, unless it has been surgically traumatized during the surgery or injured. So it does not leak, but yes, it can happen. Now, what are the factors that it can happen? If the quality of the implant is not good, so we try and use the best quality implants, which is blah, 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 FDA approved or whatever. During the surgery, just make sure that you squeeze and see if there is any defect or rent in the implant. Then you tell them about the longevity of the implant, how long does the implant last, okay, and what is the protocol now. That obviously not all the permanent implants, all the implants, breast implants are permanent. They need to change at some point of time, but there are protocols. A regular follow-up is required, where during the follow-up, if you are with me as a surgeon, I will examine you. I may recommend an ultrasound or I may recommend an MRI. Okay. Then based on that decision, if the MRI says the implant is good and the breast is good, aesthetics are good, there is no need to change the implant, even if it is after 15 years. Then the second complication is capsular contracture. So why does it happen? Where does it happen more? With what type of implant? And what can you do to prevent that? Now, obviously, before we used to say that textured implant has reduced incidence, but we can't, because we are not using textured implants. So we tell them we are using nanotextured implants. Smooth implants, or very smooth implant, has higher risk than nanotextured or textured implants or microtextured implants. Now, the good thing is Motiva, which is the nanotextured implant, has actually given a warranty that capsular contracture of grade 3 and 4 are covered by them. Okay. So if that happens, so you need to know the warranties of Mentor, Sebin and Motiva implant. Okay. Then you tell them what are the other things you will do post-operatively. You will massage, you will wear this, you will ask the patient to come back for follow-up, all of those things, or give Montelukast or whatever. And if the capsular contracture occurs, there may be a treatment required. Okay. And this treatment, of course, does not include this treatment. Then the other one is skin wrinkling and rippling. In what are the circumstances patients can see skin rippling and wrinkling? Okay. All the patients who are thin built, you need to warn them that you do not have enough body fat percentage. You do not have enough breast tissue. There is a high chance that over a period of time, you may see rippling. If it is behind the muscle, it still does not eliminate the possibility. Why? The muscle could be very thin. The pectoral muscle could be very thin. So it can happen, but behind the muscle the chances are less. So what are the causes of rippling? You can enumerate those rippling, and what are you going to do to prevent rippling? Again, you know, selection of the position most importantly. But if it happens in the future, what are the options? You may require fat grafting, for instance, to cover that. But again, that's a different procedure. So if that happens, then there will be a separate package for that. Change in the nipple and skin sensation. That yes, so far there are very few patients who have lost sensation, very, very few in numbers. And those may be because we have used extra large implants on patient request. Okay. Or they had difficult anatomy that has caused to loss of sensation, but it is extremely rare. Calcification, calcium deposits, again, it doesn't happen these days now with the modern implant. It used to happen with textured implants in the past, but you can just quickly go through. Chest wall deformity, you can tell them that everybody has a certain asymmetry or chest anomalies, okay, which does not change with the implant, but sometimes it becomes more obvious because you are critically analyzing your breast and you tend to identify these problems in the future. Implant displacement, yes, displacement can happen. So just follow the instructions. These are the things you're going to do to prevent the displacement, particularly behind the muscle. If you use aggressively in the muscle, it will push it out of the pocket. Okay. So rotation, migration, but if that happens, obviously we'll have to do a redo procedure to reposition the implant. Of course, that's not covered in this cost. Surface contamination of the implants. Yeah, we make sure what we do prevent all of those things, steps we follow. Breastfeeding, again the same thing, it's personal experience. Most of the patients we know have been able to breastfeed, but a breastfeeding capability sometimes does not depend on an implant. It could be an inherent incapability of a person, anatomy or function, that they are not able to breastfeed. So it's very rare that breast implant will stop the capability of unless a very large implant is used which will compress your breast tissue, or nerve is affected that will lose sensation in the nipple. Okay. Then unusual activities and occupations. Ensure that you do not do this, which could cause potentially, you know, displacement or trauma or rupture or all of those things. Then inherent surgical risk of the implant surgery, which is actual surgery. So you could have bleeding. Again, we have never not seen bleeding, you know, never happened. But these are the things you do. You don't take these medications. For postoperative, they take this care. What we do is we use special technique, Thomasson technique, which minimizes the bleeding. So the surgery is almost bloodless for us during the surgery. But after surgery also matters what you do, how you know your stress, sudden increase in blood pressure can cause bleeding and hematoma. This is also in a way to tell them that calm down, don't get upset, angry, you know, just be quiet. And then there are a lot of factors that can happen because of them. Alright, so part of it is also telling them how equally they are responsible, you know, for the complications. It's not only the surgeon, it's all the factors, including the surgeon, surgery time, the implant, the manufacturer, lot of things are involved in that. So you subtly just tell them that how the responsibilities are divided basically. Seroma formation, the same thing about the seroma formation. Infection, so what you can tell is you have never seen infection, you have, you know, performed or you've been part in this group and we have seen so many patients but never had any infection. But theoretically it is possible. If there is infection, we have no choice but to take you in the hospital, remove the implant and wait for 6 months before we can do an implant. Okay. But how can we avoid infection? By doing preoperative protocol, all of those things. Now, yeah, skin scarring. So this is the most important thing, skin scarring and the change in the breast shape over a period of time, particularly in augmentation mastopexy. You have to tell them that the scars, we will do our best to make the scar as fine as possible. So which means what we do is minimal traumatic surgery, fine suturing, internal, okay, we'll provide you good aftercare, but a lot depends on your body healing. The best scar is that you will have a fine white line, which is what we want, but the scar can stretch. If that happens, if you ask for an oversized, if you ask for a bigger implant and your skin is, you know, we have to close it in tension, the scar would stretch. So you partially also put the message across that don't ask for too big implant. Or if your body changes over a period of time with weight loss and weight gain, the breast position changes, the scar can also change. Or you could develop a hypertrophy of scar, which is very rare, but it may happen. So if this happens, then there may be a further treatment required for scar, which is again not covered in the package. that you will have to you will be paying separately, although we provide you with special offers and for injections, for lasers or for scar revisions, but that is not covered in the surgery. The breast position and the firmness, remember that we try to make it as firm as possible, okay, but obviously it is our judgment. If you try to make it too tight, the wound may not heal and you may have complications which could be a disaster. So we have to make sure that it is adequately tightened, yet it allows good healing. So what happens is body tissue is such that you may see the next day perfectly tight and firm, but over a period of months it could become more lax, and that happens because of the elasticity of your tissue. The only way you could minimize that is by wearing support, having a healthy diet, making sure you don't fluctuate in weight a lot. But not everything is under your control or my control. So sometimes it may happen that 6 months later you may have change in the shape of the breast that may concern you, and we can correct that. There is a possibility that can be improved, but obviously that's not covered in the package. Okay. Any surgery, tell them that we try our best. I think we are suitable candidate, but there may be reasons why you may be unsatisfactory, and the unsatisfactory or dissatisfaction may be because of small implant. Again, you can say that most of the time, yeah, patient do say that, yeah, I wish I had gone a little bit bigger. So we will do this assessment and tell you this is what you can go up to. Secondly, sometimes some patients say it is small in the beginning, but over a period of time, 6 months, 1 year, they come back and they say, I'm glad that I did not go for bigger size. Third possibility is that the implant is too big, which is very rare. It has not happened so far in our history, but it can happen. If that happens, then we have to remove the implant, put a smaller one. Obviously, again, that's not covered in the package. Unsatisfactory result could be poor scar. Again, I have explained to you the reason for the scars. Or it could be because of the poor, unacceptable shape of the breast, which again I have explained to you. Delayed healing, the wound sometimes heals within 10 days. Any wound, any part in the body can take about 10 days to 2 weeks to heal. But there may be some delay in the healing, like because of suture reactions, because of sweating, because of perspiration, because of skin eczema reactions, there may be delayed in healing. So during this time, we will follow you up. Obviously, we don't charge for this one. But if there is anything required to do a resuturing, which is after about a month or so, that is not covered. I will tell you what is covered in our package, what we are providing to the patients. And you also mentioned that smokers have greater risk of skin loss. Some people have more risk of wound complications, particularly if you are a smoker. Whether they stop smoking or not, they know about it. Okay. Always about asymmetry. Tell them that it's not possible to make it 100% symmetrical, although we will do measurement during the surgery, before the surgery, and you will see it will be an exact measurement, but things change when you lie down, things change when the breast reacts to the surgery. So there may be one side more swelling than the other side. A redo surgery for asymmetry is very rare, it's not very common, but if that is required, it is possible, we can adjust to some extent, but obviously that is also not covered in the package. Risk of surgical anesthesia. Both local and general anesthesia involved has risks. So you need to just eliminate that. How we have eliminated the general anesthesia risk. We have performed 10,000, 20,000 operations with no problem at all. Why? Because the quality of the hospital that we choose, the anesthesiologists that are working with us have been there for a long time. The material that we use is of high quality. Okay. And we ensure that it is bloodless, it is short procedure and all of those things. So these eliminates the surgical risk. And we follow the protocol to prevent DVT or whatever, you know. Allergic reactions, do not forget to tell that as well. We ignore it, but many times the patient will have a lot of rashes for whatever reason and they will blame you for that rashes. So tell them it's possible that you may have allergic reactions sometimes to some medications which can be treated immediately, sometimes to tapes. Okay, we use the best quality tape. We really use the best quality Elastoplast that we have here. I don't use the red one because the red one causes more. But still that can cause a reaction, okay, and that's why we use only for 1 day. And then, and remember, when I put this, I try to put least on the skin. Most of the places it is covered by packs, but that has a disadvantage that it may come off, so you have to instruct the nurses. If it comes off, reinforce it. Thrombosed veins, and particularly in the breast after the implant, they may have more veins visible. Sometimes the veins get thrombosed. They may have thrombosis where the IV line is. That's why we prefer not to keep the patient for too long in the hospital. Some patients who are demanding to stay in the hospital, that we like it to be removed, you know, so you don't have all of these problems. About the pain, you can explain, you know, what kind of pain they can experience and what you do during the surgery, and what if there is pain afterwards. You know, there are some pain that you have to accept, it is okay. For others, you can take Panadol, Brufen, etc. Then additional breast implant advisory information, which is breast cancer. That there has been a lot of research that has been done so far, and it has been proved beyond doubt that implant does not cause or has any factor affecting risk of breast cancer. Okay. However, there has been some reported incidences where a certain type of implant has caused reaction in the body, which has caused immunogenic reaction, which has caused ALCL. Some people may know, most of them they don't know, but you mention it to them. So what you're going to prevent that is you choose the implant which is, you know, smooth, and we will follow you up, and we recommend that you follow up in long term every year, either with your surgeon or wherever you are in a country with a plastic surgeon. And after 5 years, now they say actually every 2 years you should do an MRI, or every 5 years you do an MRI. Okay. If there is fluid formation, if they ask more detail, then you can go more in depth. That yeah, if there is, usually it presents as only seroma, and seroma can be treated if it is identified immediately by draining the seroma, sending it for testing, all of those things. Or it could present as lumps in the capsule, okay, or very rarely with metastasis. Then about mammography and ultrasound and MRI, when to do, how to do, and you know, what are the precautions they have to, or what information they have to give to the radiologist. Then you talk about long-term results. Tell them about the long-term result is because of weight loss, weight gain, aging changes, pregnancy and other factors, the breast could change over a period of time and there will be continuous sagging. Breast is never static. Everybody goes through that process. Okay. So do be aware that it may change, and in future you may want to do a redo surgery or a further lift with removal and replacement of breast implants. Future revision, removal, all of these things are possible. There may be unacceptable results in the future, which is again not covered in the present package. Then immune system diseases, we know that again, that's also implant is a problem. Then health insurance. The package that you are giving, we are covering your emergencies. There is a hematoma, we will not charge them. Even if you have to go back to the hospital, we will not charge them. But if the cover is up to only 50,000 dirham. If for example, anything happens, God forbid, they are in ICU, up to 50,000 it covers. Beyond that, the patient pays. So it covers hematoma, it covers infection, it covers wound gaping, additional surgery necessary. These are the most, you need to say additional surgery necessary and financial responsibility. This is the most important thing that you need to tell, not the nurses, not the coordinators. So this is the package that you're doing, will cover, make sure that this doesn't happen or this happens, we will treat you. But after that, if anything happens, there may be procedure required, you know, which may require some days. We'll try to minimize the cost. Some of this can be done in-house, so you just pay for consumables. Or if it is done in the hospital, you only pay for hospital and the anesthesiology charge and the consumables, but it will not be free. Okay. So it's very important. Now, this is where you will identify patients. Some patients who are understanding, they will say, yes, yes, yes. They follow everything. They are your best patients.